So we're very lucky to have Dr. Saba and Dr. Daphne Munroe here, who are going to talk about the latest state of knowledge in the connections of the cold pool to ecology in the region. So looking at fin fish, looking at shellfish, but also some of the acidification consequences of the cold pool. And so I think Grace is going to start, and then Daphne will follow. So thank you for coming to present.
Mid-Atlantic Bight. I'll show a figure in just a minute showing comparisons of chlorophyll between seasons. But we get a decent amount of chlorophyll. They're typically in inshore waters at shallow depths because there is less light in the wintertime through clouds and just less light during the day. And so they typically stay inshore where there's a little bit more light. So there is quite a bit of chlorophyll in the winter. So in the springtime, again, we start seeing that stratification set up. We see this fresh water coming in through storms, and then that can bring in nutrients as well. And then this stratification starts setting up a big spring bloom. So basically what happens is the phytoplankton in the water become, they're not light limited at all anymore, or not very much at least, because of the stratifications that suddenly have a lot of light in the surface layer. So you can get big spring blooms, a lot of phytoplankton that does support zooplankton and then the fish that are on the shelf. The spring blooms, if you see the chlorophyll here, they're typically more offshore, and that's because that fresh water coming in brings also a lot of terrigenous material. Kind of the water is a little bit murky, a little darker, so they're typically offshore where there's better stratification and less and more light. And then we get the oxygen. You can start seeing kind of oxygen maximum layer in that along where the thermocline is, and that's the phytoplankton actually producing oxygen. So you can see that in the oxygen signal. And you can also see that in the pH signal. So you get pretty relatively higher pH where there's, because the phytoplankton are taking up that carbon dioxide, so you're getting this vertical difference now in pH, and you're getting lower pH in the bottom waters. So you're starting to set up probably a lower oxygen and lower pH in the bottom waters through that remineralization process, and also the flip side, the photosynthesis process. So a lot of stuff happening starting in the springtime with respect to changes in oxygen and pH and chlorophyll. Now we're in the summer, we get this really strong thermal stratification. The surface is essentially, the bottom, the cold pool, so here we see the cold pool, and that's completely cut off from the surface. The cold pool has a lot of nutrients that now the surface has a hard time getting because it's so stratified that it's very minimal mixing. So you actually get a lot less chlorophyll in the summertime. And this is what that looks like. So this is that figure I was telling you I was going to show, showing years from 98 to 2006, and then seasons going along, winter, spring, summer, fall. And the colors are chlorophyll concentrations, low to high from blues to reds. And this is MAB, Mid-Atlantic Bight average chlorophyll, monthly averages. So you can see that the summertime chlorophyll is relatively low. You can see some periodic places where you get higher chlorophyll, and those are just upwelling events that Scott was talking about that I'll show on the next slide. But you can see, surprisingly, the biggest blooms actually start in the fall. It's this fall-winter bloom. And that happens when you have that thermal stratification, you get a storm that comes in and mixes the nutrients from the bottom up to the surface, allowing phytoplankton to grow more. And so you can get some big phytoplankton blooms starting in the fall that last through winter. And you can see there's a lot of interannual variability. It's highly variable from year to year. And this is due to atmospheric physical practices. So in the winter time, you'll get more chlorophyll or more bloom in the winter if there's lower winds mixing events, just because they're light limited. So less mixing is better in the winter time for phytoplankton. I don't have a figure showing it, but the zooplankton that feed on the phytoplankton and that then feed the fish, they track chlorophyll pretty closely. There's a little bit of a time lag, because they take longer to grow, but they track the phytoplankton. So if there's high phytoplankton, eventually there's going to be a big bloom of zooplankton setting up fish food. So here's the upwelling process. Scott showed this. So you get those southwest winds causing the sea surface temperature to get real cold, that deep water coming up to the surface along the coast, bringing up all the nutrients that can then fuel a really big phytoplankton bloom. And these are episodic, but they can be spatially pretty significant. This is satellite images showing ocean color of the phytoplankton bloom that happened in the summertime of 2011. So they're episodic, but they can be pretty significant with process will take place. The good part about that is that it replenishes the nutrients in the bottom that then can be mixed to the surface for phytoplankton to grow some more. But the bad news can be that that incremental lady process is from respiring organisms, so they produce a lot of carbon dioxide, and they take up oxygen. So you can start getting low bottom dissolved oxygen in the cold pool and the salt water in general. And then you can also get lower pH. So this is showing this is Josh's work with NJDEP, and this is showing dissolved oxygen concentrations along the shelf of New Jersey. This is the lowest concentration measured at that point, typically the bottom water. It can get pretty low in the summer, so July 2012, I believe. And then this is looking at pH along the shelf, cross shelf transect of New Jersey. And you can see in these shallow shelf waters here and here, you get relatively lower pH caused from that biological activity. So there's a lot of things happening in the physics, in the chemistry, and in the biology that occur seasonally on the shelf. And then there's a lot of variability between years. So it's a very stochastic system. And then fall, we see the overturn of the cold pool, and you can see that uniform, starting to get that uniform vertical water column through salinity and temperature. When that occurs, and this is the Hurricane Sandy example shown just from one hurricane, how quickly that mixes up. But you can see how the surface water cools, but the bottom water actually warms up. And that is can drive different fish species to do different things. Some fish species that prefer to pull the water once they live on the bottom, they're not going to like this very much, and they're going to start moving offshore. Or inshore. And then on the surface, you get pelagic fish that don't like cold water and won't start moving also. The good thing about finfish is that they can move, so they have the ability to adapt a little bit just from moving. They have their seasonal migrations are timed with these temperature changes, which I'll show in just a minute. So, like I just said, life histories of many species are attuned to changes in the cold pool. These are seasonal changes, but also long-term changes that are occurring that we're been observing now for a while. And these are just some examples of some species that I'll talk about today. Daphne's going to cover some of the shellfish, and then I'll talk about some of the important finfish that have relationships with the cold pool. But life histories, things like the timing of their migration, spawning, recruitment, and abundance, can be related to, or at least linked to, the cold pool and the processes of the cold pool. Why is this? So the organisms are strongly controlled by temperature. So temperature primarily is what impacts organism physiology. So when we talk about that, I'll use the word environmental stressors because that's what I study. But when you think about environmental stressors, things like temperatures that are too warm or too cold, ocean acidification, so changes in pH that impact how an organism is going to respond. So essentially what those kinds of changes do, so higher temperatures and ocean acidification can actually cause a higher requirement for oxygen in food because it increases their metabolic rate. If your metabolic rate increases, you just need more food to support that increased energy requirement. And then when we have hypoxia or acidification, in some cases, you can get metabolic suppression, which is the opposite. So an organism will just get stressed, and then will just kind of shut down because, I mean, they'll try to wait it out until maybe they see some better conditions. So both of those things, though, can impact things like reproduction. They'll put less energy into reproduction if they're dealing with stressors on their physiological system. But they can also have changes in heart rate. So warm temperatures will actually increase the heart rate of a fish. That can be problematic with energy requirements. And then there's some behavioral impairment that can occur, specifically with ocean acidification. It can influence their neurotransmitters and cause them to just act funny, not be able to find prey, not be able to escape predators. So there's a multiple responses organisms face when they're in or under conditions of stress through these limitation. If they have higher energy requirements, they're going to need more food to handle that, or they're going to have to move to another location, which is also going to require energy. Ultimately, that can cause reductions in growth and reproduction because they're not being able to utilize that energy to put towards that. And then increased predation, and that's specifically if you're behaviorally or neurologically impaired, you're going to have a hard time escaping predators. So organisms have an optimum condition, and that's, I'll talk about temperature mainly today, but essentially you can get a curve that looks something like this. This is temperature from lower to higher, and we look at aerobic scope. Now what aerobic scope is essentially, we call it a measure of an organism's fitness. So what we look at, so if we look on this figure, we have the metabolic rate, which is the rate of oxygen consumption, the amount of oxygen organisms are breathing, and over a certain temperature here, so again, low to high, which I didn't have on the axis, sorry. But we can look at things like a maximum metabolic rate, and that's that flat curve here, and that's when the organism is exercising. So that's the highest amount of oxygen that they're going to require under exercise or a stress level. And then we have this line here, the standard metabolic rate. So this is when they're just resting. So what is their basal metabolic rate? And so what we look at for aerobic scope is actually the difference between these two. And then where you have a peak with temperature, that's what typically what we call a thermal optimum. And essentially what that means is that there's a lot of excess energy here available for things like foraging, escaping predators, migrating, and reproduction. So if you can maximize the energy here, it just means you have more energy to help your fitness. So we call that an optimum when we look at that across temperature ranges. So we can have an optimum temperature, but then we have a range of temperatures where, you know, they can perform pretty well. Once we get on either side of that, under really cold temperatures or really warm temperatures, the organism just kind of ceases to function properly. And that can, they can die, of course, there's mortality impacts, but also they can just not reproduce, which impacts the population as a whole. So this is one thing that we're really looking at in lab experiments. This is just one image showing black sea bass in a chamber where you can get these measurements. But we can also look at these curves through just the fisheries data. So we can look at the NOAA fisheries data set and see where the fish are in relation to temperature. And we can plot, you know, where they're normally at temperature curve. Oh, okay, better fish like 18.1 degrees on the shelf. So we can look at these a different way, but it allows us information to figure out where their habitat, their preferred habitat might be on the shelf. So it gives us a lot of information when we have this data. Oxygen, though, is also very important because as temperature increases, their oxygen demand increases. So we can measure what their oxygen demand is and what their oxygen consumption rate is. But then their oxygen carrying capacity, which is essentially their blood can absorb oxygen, but at higher temperatures it has a harder time absorbing that oxygen and using it for energy. So this is an example showing those types of processes under different temperatures. So blue is at 10 degrees, this is a jumbo squid. Red is at 20 degrees, and then this is your oxygen consumption rate on the y-axis, and then here is your partial pressure of oxygen. So it's what the animal's exposed to, it's how much oxygen they have available. So at high oxygen levels, they have high oxygen consumption rates, there's plenty of oxygen, they don't have to shut down any processes, and they're working fine. But once you start decreasing that external oxygen availability, they'll start reducing their oxygen consumption. And then you'll hit a breaking point here, and this is called your critical oxygen level, where they just shut down and can't function. And that's what we're looking at. And temperature has a big impact on what that number is. So at a higher temperature, the critical level is at a higher level of oxygen. So they're less tolerant at higher levels of oxygen. So that's what we're concerned about, is with any kind of increases in temperature, whether it be seasonal or long-term, we're concerned about, it's basically going to reduce their habitat with respect to oxygen availability. And then we can look at things just like hypoxia tolerance. This is a black sea bass experiment done with from my graduate student Emily Schlesinger. But you can measure percent oxygen saturation, and this number is essentially anything below this number is your business not able to function properly. So if you have a higher number of oxygen saturation, that means they're less tolerant of hypoxia, which is low oxygen conditions. So that temperature obviously has another big influence on what that tolerance is. So at higher temperatures, black sea bass do pretty well here up to about 24 degrees, and then past 27 degrees, their hypoxia tolerance decreases pretty significantly. And so, again, temperature has a big impact on oxygen demand and how efficiently they're able to use it. So that kind of sets up why these organisms have the distribution patterns that they have throughout season and throughout years and over long-term changes. So one thing that they are tuned to the global is the migrations. So this is a winter flounder will actually move inshore in the winter to spawn, whereas a black sea bass and butterfish will move offshore. But these are triggered by changes in the cold pool, so the fall overturn, for instance. So once the summer stratification breaks down, the storm comes through, the temperature has changed dramatically in the system, and that overturning signals these organisms to start moving wherever they're going to move. And it's different for different fish, obviously, as you can see here. I'll just show the example of butterfish. This is work done by Josh, Laura Mazzaro, and John Anderson. And this is the butterfish. So in the summertime, they're real near shore, and then they move offshore in the wintertime. And it's the timing of the migration that's dictated by that cold pool overturn. So butterfish have a thermal optimum of 18.1, and they have a fall offshore migration trigger right at 15 degrees. And they were able to do this by looking at, they ran a GAM model on using the NEMAP, so the real near shore fisheries surveys, and they can see when the abundance basically drops once the shell temperatures or those near shore temperatures reach 15 or below. And so you won't find any butterfish in that near shore system temperatures below 15. So it's a really interesting study that they did to see the exact temperature of when they're just completely gone. So the butterfish are triggered by that change in temperature, and then they all just start moving offshore. So that's the migration story, but abundances, just general abundances of organisms can be tied to cold pool temperatures. This is yellowtail flounder, which has a temperature of preference, a pretty low temperature, so 4 to 8 degrees, so it likes that cold water. There's been actually quite a few, this is a study from Sullivan in 2000, but there's been a lot of work done with yellowtail flounder and temperature in the recent past also. And they all have seen this pattern where you get just higher numbers of young yellowtail flounder in this cold pool, and these are looking at the numbers are the temperature, and then the circles are the number of caught per toe or trawl in the trawl. And so you can see just they have really high numbers in those cold temperatures in the cold pool. So their abundance is really directly tied to cold pool.
These summer pictures?
Yes. Yeah, sorry.
Thanks.
And they've even found evidence of they will experience mortality outside of the cold pool thermal boundaries just from the temperature, the higher temperature. So on the flip side, some fish that like warmer temperatures will actually do better once that cold pool overturn happens. So because the bottom tempers are actually getting warmer. So silverhake is one, and Atlantic croaker is another one where they have positive associations with the presence and location of those warmer waters in the bottom once that cold pool breaks breaks down. So again, it's very highly variable between species and highly variable between seasons. Some species use pole as just a refuge. So the winter flounder can use it as a refuge. They're adapted to the cold water. They spawn in cold water typically in the winter, springtime, but the peak is in Mid-Atlantic here, February, March time. And then they're seeking colder temperatures during summer. So they can use a cold pool as a refuge for species that like cold temperatures. And then in some species that are historically distributed farther north, the cold pool can act as a temporary refuge for some of these. So haddock and Atlantic cod, where you can actually find some here in the cold pool during summertime. So the cold pool can act as a refuge for these more northern species, but also it allows them to temporarily extend their range southward. So we've seen, Travis showed a little bit of this. We see highly variable changes through seasons, through years, and now we're starting to look at what those long-term changes are. And this is a paper showing temperature trends from 1982 to 2014 in the surface along the Northeast Shelf, but also in the bottom waters. And we're seeing, you know, temperature trends in both surface and bottom waters. So we are, you know, starting to think about how this might impact fish. We do know that there's evidence of fish continuing to shift northward for some species, but basically tracking those changes in temperature. So they're moving either northward, or if they're not moving north here, they're moving towards deeper water, whatever direction that is for them. So this is an example showing some species. This is a lobster, yellowtail flounder, summer flounder, and red hake. And this is latitude, so going from south to north. The axes are different for these different species, so just keep note of that. But essentially, you can see kind of northward trends of all four of these species over time since the 1970s. But again, you can see that high variability between years. Very, very highly variable. If you get a nice cold year here in the cold pool, like here, you're going to see a lot of yellow flounder, which is good. So a lot of variability, but we still are seeing those long-term changes. And then here on the right, this is just visually showing the red hake distribution changes from 1968 going over time, and this is the most recent, but you can see that the distribution shifting to the north. For now, we're not seeing hardly any red hake in the middle. Okay. So we're concerned about, you know, future directions need to be focus on timing, any changes in the timing of cold pool, because that's really important for migration patterns and abundance and things like that for several different species of fish. So we're concerned about just temperature in general, but also concerned about the timing of when those things happen. So I'm going to pass this on to Daphne and I'm going to focus on the shellfish.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. functional, the stability of the cultural is really, really important to the existence of these species here on the shelf, where we have actually a lot of habitat as well, because the continental shelf is so wide. So I'm going to talk about what the implications of some potential changes in the cold pool are to mollusks, and I'm going to talk about them in the context of growth, survival, and reproduction, and I'm going to give a bunch of kind of examples along the way. But first, I want to kind of touch back to what Grace was talking about, which is this idea of scope for growth. And so the way this works for mollusks, they don't thermoregulate, which means their body temperature is dependent on the temperature of their air. They can't control their body temperature. It just happens, their body temperature is a reflection of what the water temperature they're in. And so as you go from low to high temperatures, their respiration increases, okay? So they need more and more energy as temperature increases. Their ingestion, their ability to compensate for that and feed themselves, goes up with temperature to a point, and then it drops off. And this point is that optimum difference between these two lines, is that thermal optimum. But the point here is, when you get out into this range out here, they may be able to compensate for a period of time with their own internal resources, but they're not going to have a lot of extra energy to produce. And if they stay out here in these temperatures that are past this break point for too long, they'll die. So one of the first things I'm going to talk about is impacts on growth, and I'm using surf plants here as this example. This area out here, for the folks in the room that are clam people, this is what in the survey we call Stratum 21. This is an area that has a lot of survey data, and it's directly off New Jersey. It's also an important part of the commercial fishery. This here is a time series starting in 1990 going up to early 2012. This is a plot of the maximum body size from the survey. This is not fish, this is not the catch, this is from a survey. So this is from the Federal Survey. And what you see over time is that the maximum body size has been declining in surf plants. And again, this data comes from this one kind of spot, Stratum 21, which is kind of a hot spot in the center of the distribution. And I'll go back real quick. This is about a 10% drop in body size of the shell length, okay? Which may not sound like much, 10% smaller plants, right? Who cares? The clam guys care a lot, because maximum body size in length, 10% in length, is actually a 40% drop in biomass. That's what they are fishing and selling, right? So it's almost being cut in half in terms of the weight of that biggest clam that's out there. And so we did some work to look at what kind of temperatures you need to drive that kind of drop in body size. Because again, with scope for growth, if you're getting over in the edge of where you can have extra energy to grow bigger, your maximum size is constrained. So what this figure shows, and this is just a summary here, is that with an increase in temperature, and we were simulating clam growth, population growth with temperature time series that were either on the warm side, these are what we think are realistic annual time series, or on the cold side relative to the climatology that's out there. They still have a seasonal cycle, etc. But we can definitely get 10% or more decline in the maximum body size in surf plants from these simulations just with a change in temperature. And fishing overlays on that, but fishing doesn't change the maximum body size nearly as much as temperature does. We also know that the distribution of the clams is shifting. This graph is a little bit hard to follow, but I'll walk you through it. These panels here are years 1982 through to 1987, 97, up to 99, and then down to 2015. And this is a figure that Dan Hennen made in one of the stock assessment reports. And what this shows is this is clams caught again in the survey. This is not fish clams, this is from the survey. And this is these are clams caught by depth. This is depth across the x-axis in each of the years. And this is where they're catching the clams in the survey. This dotted line shows the median of where they're catching the most clams. Okay, and so I've just taken that dotted line and I've plotted it here as a time series. And so this is the median depth of the surf clam biomass coming in the survey off New Jersey over time, starting in 1982 through to 2015. And you see that back in the early 80s, they were catching the majority in the survey in about 15 liters depth. Today, they're catching it out in 40 liters depth. So the clams have moved offshore, the bulk of the biomass, and I'll point out that's not all clams, there are clams in but the bulk of the biomass, the happiest, fattest clams, are out there in deeper water now. So this is not something that's new. We've known this for a while. The fisheries known it for a good bit of time. The clams, the surf clams have been moving north and moving offshore. We also took a look at that process because we, and in this, we really learned some things about how the cold pool stability is working to as an interplay in this mortality. And so what we did is we again took a population model of clams. We calculated the population of clams, and we calculated these populations of clams over time, and we drove that population with bottom water temperature time series that Enrique Kirchester calculated, and we used these 9 locations. So they're kind of transects that go across the shelf in surf clam neighborhoods. Inshore is the black line, the middle shelf is the red line, and the outer shelf is the blue line. And we've got this New Jersey population and a couple more populations down south in Delmarva. And one of the reasons that it's nice to have this ROMS time cast of bottom water temperature time series, and there's some really great work being done observing the bottom water conditions today, but we don't have a lot of continuous records of temperature, and we really, in order to make these kinds of calculations, we need continuous records, and so we use these model continuous records. And here's one of those cycles. This is the inshore most population. The black line is mortality in those clam populations over time, and the colored dots, and I'm really glad you guys have been looking at temperature plots all day, so I don't have to explain too much about what's going on here, but this is years across the x-axis and months on the y-axis. Each box is the average bottom temperature for that month. So you see this cold pool feature here. It's really stable in most years, and you see the warming in October or so when things break down. But I'm going to focus on this one year, 1974, because up here in New Jersey, this population didn't really experience much mortality. But further south, this population in our model experienced very, very high mortality. So we wanted to unpack that to see if we could figure out what kind of processes were driving this. And I've highlighted, now we're looking at a profile here. This is the surface, and this is the bottom where the clams are. Again, the colors are the temperature, so you see this really nice stratification that we've been talking about so far today. This box is showing you that year where we had big mortality down here and not so much in New Jersey. And what happens is, up in New Jersey, you see the stratification hung on for longer than it did in the south. And what that did is it protected those clams that were on the bottom from prolonged extreme heat. And this red color is up here in this box. And remember, that's outside the window of what they can handle. They max out at about 22, 24 degrees. But down here in the south, there was a mixing event in the model that put very warm water to the bottom early in the season, and then that water stayed. And those stimulated populations couldn't handle it. And so this is all really great because it's a model, so it tells us that this may be a thing, but we don't know if it's for sure a thing, right? So one of the things that I did is I looked back in the assessment record, and again, the clam guys are, I hate to pick at old wounds, guys, but this is assessment data for biomass of clams, and these are from the survey. Again, these are, they drag a dredge, and they estimate how many clams are on the bottom. This is not a modeled result. So these are their actual survey results. And these are surveys in 1994, and 1997. And so what happened was they went out in 1994, and they were seeing, surf clam biomass abundances like at this level, and then suddenly in 94 there were so many more clams out there. And they saw that in New Jersey and also in Delmarva. And they finally thought this is great, this means the population's coming up. But they went out again 3 years later, and the abundance numbers were way down. And so they thought to themselves, this can't be a real number, because you couldn't have gone, these are long-lived species, you couldn't have gone from this level up and then back down. This must have been an anomalous result. I would argue that possibly this could be a real result if you had a mortality event in between these two observations. And so in the assessment, what they did is they basically threw out the 1994 value because they presumed it was due to a voltage problem with the dredge. So they thought it was an equipment issue, and they didn't use that 1994. 1994, okay, so there was 1994 and 1997 with those two observations. So if 1994 was a high biomass year, it could have been real in terms of relative to the value you see in 1997 if you had a big mortality event somewhere in between, 95 and 96. And so what we actually see is, in fact, we see this kind of early destratification and mixing of warm water down to the bottom in 1995. And so this model actually kind of supports the idea that maybe it wasn't a voltage problem with the dredge. And I use this as an example, again, to say, you know, it's great that we can model these things and it can suggest some processes to us, but without data and, you know, going back to, you know, having actual data and real numbers to draw on to try to question whether these are real, we kind of are making guesses. In this case, I was able to go back to the Globeck report from 1995. So here's some real data. I've overlaid with these yellow X's what the model was using to force the plant population model. And what actually happened was there were warmer than average, anomalously warm bottom water temperatures observed in the Globeck survey in 1995. So there was some suggestion, the data supports that a little bit, that that might have been the case. But again, I'll go to this point that having data is really important to be able to go back and figure out what maybe the dynamics have been. And I don't at all want to take away from the fact that observing now and forward is really, really important. But I'll point out that with these bivalves, we have recorders out there on the bottom that, in this case, the ocean quahog lives to a couple hundred years. We can use these recorders. They're set in one place. They haven't moved. And their shell is a recorder of certain environmental conditions. And this poster came from some work that was supported by NSF and SEMVIS, which is an industry partnership to support research like this. Work that came out of Roger Mann's lab. So what you're looking at is these rings are annual rings. You can't read it from the back, but over here we're talking about, this is 1845, that line there. They wrote that too. And so you've got this really nice record, and there's been some really great work done in Iceland recently, in recent decades, where they're interested in tracking paleoclimate records. So using shells from Arctica and then an ocean quahog to back calculate ocean bottom water temperatures. And so this paper here, they're going back almost 1,400 years using current and fossilized ocean quahog shells to back calculate temperature time series. And this is a really nice recent review where they're pointing out that there's a lot to be done here. It's not like you can just pull a shell and magically recalculate temperatures or growth rates, but there are some really powerful tools at our fingertips in terms of these shells. Ocean quahogs are particularly long-lived, 200-year records, but surf clams can give us, in some cases, 30-year records. Live surf clams are at their own shelf right now. So I bring this up because I think this is an important opportunity to think about also research opportunities to look at historical trends and dynamics. So I'll talk about another aspect of mortality. It might be, you know, we think what I just talked about was constraints on these inshore and southern edges of the range in terms of warm bottom water temperatures moving those species offshore and northward. In this case, we're looking at sea scallops, and we're also considering the fact that one of their predators, this is a sea star that lives out in deeper water, it actually doesn't like cold winter temperatures. And so the cold pool also plays a role in that. And so as cold pool dynamics change, that may allow that predator to move inshore. And so then the sea scallop range is not only being pinched by their tolerance of summer temperatures, warm summer temperatures in the inshore side, also by their predator that's moving in when winter temperatures are warming. Han Shang up at the Northeast Fisheries Science Center has been doing most of this modeling for us. And here's an example. She's using a biological model to link to temperature. And then we've got temperature, model temperature from Enrique's model. And she's able to calculate habitat area over time that takes into account both these inshore constraints for the scallops but also offshore constraints for their predator. And that's a map of how it changes over time. But scallops. What you see is this area of Long Island has been trending down and losing habitat for scallops up there. Hudson Canyon, likewise, trending down. Elephant trunk, remarkably stable in terms of the calculations we're making. And this relates to something that Travis pointed out, and thank you for pointing it out, Travis. On some of the, in some of these spots along the edge of where the cold pool would sit, there's invagination. So there are spots where these are historic valleys, right, or historic estuaries. So where the Delaware estuary comes out, the elephant trunk is actually a bathymetric feature, right? That's why it's called the elephant trunk. It's a depression. And so our idea here is that this stability and habitat in this one spot is related to this depression that's holding cold water there longer than it would otherwise. Delmarva, we're seeing habitat bottom out at some points in the time series, and Virginia, likewise, where we've lost habitat considerably down there. We're going to use this model with IPCC forecast to try to forecast future habitat range. That work is still in progress. Mortality isn't just related to temperature that the animals or the predators are experiencing, but maybe also related to some of the parasites and the diseases they cause. In this case, this is some work most of you know, Dave Rutter's at VIMS. We've collaborated with him looking at this nematode, a parasite that infects Atlantic sea scallops. These pictures here show you the nematode infection over time. This is 2014 through 2018. You see that the nematode showed up in the south and has kind of expanded and stabilized itself down in the southern regions. It's patchy. It's not everywhere. It is also not a human health threat at all. We've done a bunch of experiments with that. I like eating scallops. But what was interesting when we first started studying this, we didn't think this was a problem in terms of the scallops themselves. We thought the scallops could handle this nematode parasite without a problem. We were keeping, for a certain experiment, we were keeping scallops in the lab and tracking their survival. And what you see here is across this x-axis, these are uninfected scallops. And we find that out after they die. We go in and we look for worms. And these are the scallops that had heavy lesions. And what you see is that this is the percent that died in 40 days in the lab. A much higher percentage, it's correlated with the number of lesions. So when they have more worms, they tend to die at a higher rate. This is in the lab, so it's artificial. It's not something we're expecting to see. This experiment wasn't designed to test this. But what it suggests potentially is that, you know, if this, this parasite is related to temperature, it could also be having an influence on the health and the survival of scallops on the shelf. I'll wrap up now with talking about wave whelk. This is another mollusk. Same kind of processes at play in terms of physiological response to cold pool. This is work done by one of my graduate students, Sarah Borsetti. This is the global distribution of wave whelk. So you see there's some populations of fish over here in Europe. And then the Canadian population, here's us down in the Mid-Atlantic. And I show this map to point out just how much further south these critters can live in the world here in the Mid-Atlantic. And this is largely due to the cold pool. The cold pool puts cold water on the bottom where these guys live for much longer. So their habitat extends latitudinally much further south than it does in other parts of the world. But what Sarah has been looking at most recently, and this is a collaboration with some industry sampling and some RSA funds, she's been looking at reproductive timing. So over here in these populations over in Europe, these clocks show you when they're laying eggs. These dark shaded areas are egg-laying periods. December is 12 o'clock, January is 1 o'clock. And so you see that these guys are laying eggs through kind of the winter months, sometimes extending in some populations into the spring. But over here in New Jersey, we have the opposite timing. And again, this has to do with the cold pool. The cold pool keeps cold water through the summer. Like now, it's cold out there. And what that means is that the biology is responding to that. So in terms of reproductive cycles and those kinds of timing, it's very different because of the cold pool. So just